Welcome. Today is a very great day. We have with us today on this very platform Professor Akilita Uzoma, the Archbishop, a member of the Last Covenant, to talk to us. We are very, very happy today, and it's also a very great day for everybody in this universe. We are coming to hear the word of the Lord from the great prophet, the former occult grandmaster, and also the avatar. We are coming to listen to him on the issues of how God Almighty protects his children. That is, you are welcome today.
The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. Very good.
Okay.
Let us pray. Father, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I thank you this moment and I pray that you speak to us and let somebody somewhere benefit in our world. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Daddy, today, my wish is that we want to talk to the issue of divine protection. Because the issue of protection has become an issue nowadays. A lot of people in institutions, in everywhere, is seeking protection. And because they don't know where to go, some of them, it landed them in where they don't have even to go. A lot of them have joined a lot of society because of protection. So that today I want to know how our God protects us through the element, or how the element, God used the element to protect his children.
Now, we want to make this point clear. God's divine protection flows through different channels, but primarily the elements of the universe are involved. God protects his children through the elements. The universe is composed of 24 elements. 24 elements. Apart from the elements that are evident on earth, such as water, fire, earth, and air, you also have the ether, which intermingles with the air. When we talk about the four elements of the earth, we talk about water, fire, air. But the ether also intermingles with the air. So, but the ether on its own is a fifth element. The ether is the sky, but it mingles with the air. Now, apart from this, you have 19, when you include the ether, which is the sky, then you now have extra other 19 elements that are subtle. Subtle means they are beyond the reach of mundane science. They are within the subtle spheres of being. When you bring all these elements together, then the universe is composed. In the ancient Vedas, these elements are called Mahat Tattva. They represent the external energy of the Almighty God. It is the words spoken by God that activate these elements into manifestations of species. All species in the universe are within the framework of 8,400,000. There are 8,400,000 species in the universe. And these are manifestations of the 24 elements at different levels, different gestalts, different paraphernalia representing manifestation. So when we talk about God's divine protection through the elements, we are saying that when you are standing upon the platform of light in Christ, all the elements of the universe, they work in the name of the Lord to give you protection. We are saying that each of these elements has its gestalt of consciousness. Consciousness is not only limited to what you call animate objects, humans, animals, and all that. No. For instance, water, fire, air, ground, sound, earth, each has its own degree of consciousness, but outside the framework of human coordinated consciousness, they have their own knowing. They have their own basis of assessing reality within their framework and beyond their framework. And blessed is the man that is standing upon the platform of divine light, because he is free. When all the elements of the universe stand to protect you, then you are free. Because why is it so? Because when you talk about powers of darkness or the forces of darkness, the vicious astral forces, these forces did not create these elements. And when you are standing upon the platform of light in Christ, for instance, and somebody somewhere, an agent of darkness, or an astral entity, a vicious astral entity, a spirit of darkness, decides to come to harm you, there is no way that spirit or that agent can achieve that without passing through an existing element. The element, there's no way, when you talk about, for instance, if you talk about witchcraft attack,
yeah,
you talk about occultic attack,
yeah,
you talk about psychic attack,
yeah,
whether the attack comes through talisman,
okay,
whether the attack comes through charm,
yeah,
whether that attack comes through amulet,
okay,
through poison, whatever, it must pass through an existing element. Element that is created by God must be used. Now, when you are standing in the right position with the Spirit of the Lord, because these forces must pass through the existing element, the element will be refused to be used.
Okay.
When the element refuses to be used against you, then that is your freedom.
Okay.
Now, I want you to read, we have the Bible here. Yes. Can you read Revelation chapter 12?
Okay, Revelation chapter 12. Okay.
Are you in Revelation chapter 12?
Yes.
Okay, let us read verse, wait a minute. Let's read verse 15 and 16. Read verse 15
okay,
and 16.
Okay, the Bible says, King James Version, Revelation chapter 12.
Verse 15 and 16.
Verse 15 and 16. The Bible says that, and the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. And the earth helped woman. And the earth helped the woman. And the earth opened her mouth and swallow up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth.
Now that is the point we are making. The earth helped the woman.
The woman.
This was an intense attack, high profile attack of darkness.
Yes.
You see,
yes.
The woman is someone that was situated properly in the light of the Almighty.
Yes.
But the serpent came against her and vomited a flood
to swallow her.
The flood had specific purpose, specific intention, which was to swallow up that woman. The Bible did not say that the blood of Jesus Christ came to help the woman,
no,
or an angel of God came to help the woman,
okay,
or Jehovah God Almighty came to help the woman.
Okay.
He said that the earth helped the woman. Because when you are standing in the right place with Almighty God in spirit, everything in the universe they rise to protect you.
Okay.
And now darkness, that instrument of darkness, that channel of darkness, that serpent.
Yes.
He wanted the flood to carry the woman away.
Yeah.
But the flood must pass through an element existing, an element created by God. It must pass through the earth. That's what we are saying.
Yes.
So if the earth accepts to be used, then that attack will go through. If the earth refuse to be used, then that's nothing darkness can do.
Yes.
So now, the earth helped the woman, and what did the earth do? The earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood that the dragon cast out against the woman.
Yes.
You see, and we say something here along this line too, because we tell people that, you see, darkness, forces of darkness, the agents of darkness, is this, the physical size doesn't matter much.
Okay.
It is what is inside them. And if, as a child of God, you must have inside you what is physically bigger than you.
Okay.
That the Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You understand?
Yes.
So now you look at the, you look at it from that point, you see that the serpent vomited flood. The flood inside the serpent was bigger than the serpent.
Yes.
When the serpent came, he vomited from itself what was bigger than it. You understand?
Okay.
The flood was there. That is the situation. An agent of darkness may be small.
Yeah.
But inside that agent of darkness lies different things.
Okay.
You can even see a human being. The Bible says that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, the pulling down of strongholds. You can see a human being who is an agent of darkness moving. And that human being could be a stronghold of darkness.
Okay.
Because what is inside that person is more than the physical person that you see. Now, when you reverse or transpose the situation and bring it to the path of light, that is where we also should be involved. What is inside you, you have to be conscious of the fact that inside you lies what is greater than even the physical world. Then you believe. You see, don't treat human beings from the physical appearance. The Bible says, no man in the flesh. There was a woman that was fond of beating her house girl, not knowing that house girl was a higher up agent of darkness, and the head was covered with this. Is it, what do they call this animal? This porcupine that has
the porcupine.
No, porcupine. Yes. So the woman beat that child on the head, and that hand got paralyzed. And she didn't know after it was, because it got paralyzed after some days. She never knew it was the beauty. It was later when the Holy Spirit revealed it to us, and she was ministered to along that line, and she stopped that. She has to apologize to that child. They even received her deliverance. But it's a child. You can say a house help. But you see on top of, around her, look at what was upon on her head, porcupine. That child had to be delivered as well, and she was delivered. So that is what we are saying. That the earth helped the woman. Fire can help you. If somebody is go and organize poison that you want to poison your food, now you will cook, if it is a poison that will be cooked, use gas or stove or firewood. As you are cooking it, if you are a child of God, that fire will eat off that poison.
Okay.
When you eat your food, nothing will happen. So the blood of Jesus Christ, the angels of God, the elements, everything are involved at one time or the other, all work to protect the sons and daughters of God all over the world.
Okay.
In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Okay. Amen. Viewers, welcome back. We are still on it. I'm deeply overwhelmed about the revelation that is coming from Professor Nita Zuma, the Reverend of Last Covenant. But that is still on the issue of the divine protection. I want to know more. In fact, I want to know how, because we know a lot of immutable laws of God Almighty that are totally infallible. It cannot change. It is working on its own. I want to know how the operation of the immutable laws of God Almighty is related to the divine protection of the children. That's what I wanted to know. Then.
Yeah, when we talk about the immutable laws, we are talking about principles established that are inexorable. In actual fact, the immutable laws represent the will of God in motion. That is God in action.
Action.
If you throw something up, it falls down. That is a law within our earthly sphere.
Yeah, gravity.
The law of gravity is there.
Yeah.
The law of balance is there. Preserve a balance between the seen and the unseen.
Yeah,
so it's like you live in your world, I live in my world.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
No spirit has right now to come to you and do you anything, except to attract it, because he lives in his world, and you live in your world.
Okay.
That this such existence is established by the law of balance.
Okay.
What you call Satan, witchcraft, all these, none of them have the power to come to say, okay, you are there, I'm coming to destroy it. Such things doesn't exist. Yes, you have to break the hedge first, because the word of God says, he that breaketh the hedge, the serpent will bite him. Otherwise, you live in your world, I live in my world. So many things are kept in place. Even the planets are in their orbit, and within their axis, by the law of balance. That is an immutable law. It's unchangeable. You see, you have the law of reciprocal action, by which you reap what you sow. You have the law of homogeneity. You understand? A whole lot of universal laws. You have the law of manners and plots. You understand? And a whole lot of law. So when you talk about universal laws in the light of divine protection,
yeah,
we are saying that even Christ himself recognized the mutable laws. When he told the disciples in the book of Luke, can you read the book of Luke chapter 19, okay, chapter 10, read from verse 17 to 20. Let's see what he says there. You will see that our Lord Jesus Christ spoke of something related to,
okay, the book of Luke,
higher knowledge of spiritual warfare. Yes, read the book of Luke chapter 10, read from verse 17,
okay,
to 20.
Okay, the book of chapter 10, verse 17 to 20. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. The 20 said, notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that the spirit are subject unto you, but rather rejoice, because your names are written in heavens.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You see, he said, I have given you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. He said, nothing shall by any means hurt you. Nothing shall hurt you. But he said, in this rejoice not.
Rejoice not.
Why? That is where the mutable law comes into play.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
The mutable law, the inexorable law of the universe comes into play. That is the law of internal light radiation. But because by universal law, when light comes, darkness must flee.
Okay.
We say, darkness flee before thee, Almighty God. Then shadows depart and fade away. Amen. Darkness must flee from the light. Amen. You understand? It doesn't call for joy,
yes,
because it is fixed. You see?
Yeah.
If I throw this up now, it falls down. It doesn't call for joy.
Yes.
Because it must fall down.
Okay.
So what Christ was telling people that is to indirectly saying there, and even directly, is that they should understand that what is important is for them to be situated in light.
Right.
That is the most important thing. When you are situated in the light of the one internal legitimate spirit of Christ, anywhere you are in this world, it will be encapsulated,
okay,
by light. Darkness will not have entrance there. So what is important is when you are in light, that your name will be written in heaven. So he said that, he said, in this rejoice not. The disciples came back and said, oh, look at even the demons were subject to us, devils were subject to us in your name. Oh, the Lord said, I see Satan fall like a lightning and all that.
Yes.
But he said that, I've given you power to trade on all these things. But you see, in this rejoice not, because all these things are subject to you. In other words, try to possess the light. Try to live in the light. When you live in the light, the universal law will come into play. Darkness must flee from you, and shadows must depart and fade away.
Amen.
So that's the message we are giving to the people. We tell people that, listen, when you are praying, pray in accordance with the divine laws of the Almighty God, the mutable laws. When you make prayer, that's what we call selfish prayer.
Okay.
Selfish prayer can be hijacked by the astral forces and used against human beings, even against you praying.
Okay.
That's what we call a vicious prayer. Number one is vicious prayer. Then number two is selfish prayer. Number three is selfless prayer. Vicious prayer is all this prayer we pray. We say, oh God, come and command people with fire. I command this, that man die. This fire. No.
Okay.
That's let me tell you, the spirit of the Lord. Because when Christ came, he came as the perfect example. Elijah, Moses, all those people, they were not the perfect examples of men. They came for different assignments. But to guide man on how to walk on the path of light, to possess victory, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ came into this world. And at this particular point, he was moving. The disciples asked him, you know, people were trying to obstruct him in the village of Samaria, you know, one of the Samaritan villages. Then they said, James and John said, Lord, let us command fire to consume them, even as Elijah did. They quoted that Elijah did it. The Christ now told them, he said, you don't know the manner of the spirit that you have. And that means the manner of spirit that brought about that activity in Elijah is not of the highest order of Christ consciousness. That is why Christ rebuked them, that they don't know the manner of the spirit they have. So they shouldn't follow Elijah to be commanding fire. Now we are not following Elijah.
Okay.
We are following our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So when you command fire now to consume anybody, Christ, in as much as Christ stood against that principle, then it means that the universal spirit, the Holy Spirit, works in accordance with that immutable principle of Christ. Now, when you command fire to consume another human being, that prayer will be hijacked in the astral world, the vibration as the prayer ascends through different divine protocols. Okay. Prayer goes through different divine protocols, you understand? Yeah. Which we call coordinate points among so many things. Mm-hmm. Now, when it gets to a point, because it can't go to Christ.
Okay.
It can't go to the throne. So it must stop somewhere, and it will not be hijacked by the vicious astral forces. They put it in their different chambers. It's, in their terms, it's like saying, okay, human beings say fire should consume human beings. When you pray that fire should consume a fellow human being, that prayer will be used by the negative forces, the astral vicious forces.
Okay.
They say, okay, a human being wants fire to consume, then they gather it, because that is outside the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
These are the things they use. You may stay here now and pray fire to consume human beings in your village, in your city, in your community. When the astral forces hijack it, they may use that prayer to cause intense terrorist attack in Australia,
okay,
in Maiduguri in Nigeria, in Owerri in Nigeria, in the United States, United Kingdom. The you that originated it, the prayer, you may not even know, because this they work under subtle laws, just like as we are here now.
Okay.
A song may be going on in your mind. Let's say you are singing in your heart,
yeah.
Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's what you are singing.
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden, I will start singing that song. And it is only you that know that this song that I'm singing now has been in your mind.
Okay.
That is thought homogeneity.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So people think that kind of a thing occur because the individuals are within a particular environment.
Okay.
But we know that it can occur independent of distance.
Okay.
Uh-huh. So it is not a matter of distance.
Can occur here, can occur another place.
Yes. So through that process of thought homogeneity, when you project fire, it is hijacked somewhere.
Okay.
And then it is used to fight this world.
Okay.
Most of these great evil things, mass killings you see going on in this world, it is human beings that generate it in their mental pattern and consciousness.
Okay.
And that's why Christ told the disciples when they make such a request of commanding fire, he said, you don't know the manner of the spirit that you have. For the Son of Man has not come to kill anybody, but to save. You see, so what we are saying now is that people should desist from making vicious prayer. Most of the church Jerry overseers, some of them, they teach people to make all those visions because it appeals to the human man sentiment.
Commanding fire.
It appeals to
me.
Yes, it appeals to the human mind. People, human beings like such things. Let fire consume this enemy. Let fire. No. If you are saying let the fire consume the works of darkness, or let the fire consume the network of darkness, that's a different entirely.
Okay.
But when you say, oh, this is my uncle, he doesn't want me to pass my exam, fire, Holy Ghost, fire, consume him. That's a different thing. The word of God says, we are not fighting against flesh and blood. We are fighting against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So any vicious prayer you make here in this world is a contribution to the pool of the vicious astral forces. Now, beyond that, When you rise beyond that, people make what we call selfless prayer.
Okay.
I mean selfish prayer. Selfish prayer is when you pray much for yourself.
For yourself.
Oh God, give me shoe. Oh God, give me cloth. Oh God, give me car. Oh God, give me wife. Oh God, give me husband. That's okay, but it's selfish.
Okay.
It's in the divine spheres.
Yeah.
It is categorized on a selfish path.
Yeah.
Some of them are done, while some are not done.
Okay.
Depending on so many factors, which we are not discussing now. If you want something, put yourself on the platform of selfless prayer.
Okay.
When you kneel down and you say, oh God, the pregnant women that are about to deliver, give them birth safely. Oh God, those that are doing businesses and their means of livelihood have gone I've come down. Please increase their means of livelihood. Okay. Those that are seeking for passport and visas to travel all over the world, help them. Okay. Those that are barren, that are impotent, help them. Those that sit on the fence, they don't want to enter your kingdom, and they're obstacle from others to change them. The terrorists of this world, the kidnappers of this world, the armed robbers, the assassinators. Huh?
Okay.
Oh God, transform them. That those of them that are doing these things, because they have no other means of livelihood, please provide genuine means of livelihood for them. Now that prayer is selfless. But what people don't know is that the initiator of that prayer is the first beneficiary.
Okay. Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
If, for instance, you are traveling and you say you don't want accident, the best way for you to be free is to pray for all the people traveling that God should take away accident from them. Okay. Then your own accident, that is, then you will not have accident.
Okay. Okay.
So we should come to that platform of selfless prayer, and that is where. That is how the mutable laws work. These things are fixed by law, that if you do this, you achieve this, you do this, you achieve this, you do this. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. You are still on it. Before we continue, you have made me a lot of revelation. Because before this, all that I know is that it is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that he used to protect the faithful and even the faithless through his mercy. I was not aware of the mutable laws. I was not aware of how the elements also protect us. So, Daddy, how do the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ also come in terms of divine protection to the children? How does it also come in? I want to know.
The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ is all encompassing. It is involved in the element that protects us. It's involved in everything, but when you look at it only from the point of literal blood, you want to see the blood coming to do something. Mm. You will say, oh, what role does it play? That element that protects you is activated by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay.
The mutable laws under which protection flows, they are all activated by the blood of our. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ represents the supreme sacrifice of the Almighty God here in this planet.
Okay.
And for as long as that holy blood dropped, even if small of it, dropped here on the physical realm of earth, activates so many things in all the realms. You understand?
Okay.
Now let me tell you, there was a man. He was a bad man, known as a bad man, you know, people knew him as a murderer, as a killer.
Yeah.
So one day the man was drunk and he picked up a quarrel with somebody who believed in the Lord.
Okay.
And that man tried to avoid his quarrel, but this didn't happen in worry. The bad man went into his house, inside his house, and took knife, machete, to kill the good man. And the good man started running.
Okay.
He was shouting, "The blood of Jesus saved me, the blood of Jesus." The man was running to match at him.
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden, as the other man was shouting, "The blood of Jesus saved me, the blood of Jesus saved me, the blood of Jesus saved me," a very strange ant from nowhere appeared, struck that bad man's eye. Very, that is strange. Immediately he dropped down on the ground. He was wriggling in pain.
Okay.
Then people gathered. When people gathered at that place, they were able to disarm him. Even within a few minutes, the eyes rolled up and covered. The issue, as far as he was concerned, the issue was not about pursuing anybody. It's how to get himself out of the pain. They even carried him from there to the hospital.
Okay.
What we are saying is that the blood of Jesus took that form of a strange ant.
Okay.
To save the other man, but it has to enter. Something has to happen to this man to disarm him.
Okay.
So it doesn't mean that the blood has to flow literally, physically, and come from the sky and come. No. The blood of Jesus Christ works with all the elements of divine protection to protect the children of God in this planet.
Okay.
God bless you.
God bless you too, Daddy. Before we continue, Daddy, what I want to know is that are there divine conditions that are attached for someone to experience or be protected by the blood of Jesus Christ? Are they divine condition attached to it, or everybody is entitled for divine protection of the blood of Jesus Christ?
Now, this is in two ways. One, there are rules that you must follow.
Okay.
To activate the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ upon your life.
Okay.
That is number one. Then number two, the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ on his own has his own prerogative. He's not bound by rule.
Okay.
I mean that is God.
Okay.
Eh? Mm-hmm. So but the first aspect is that you are expected to be pure. Say, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. You are expected to live a life that is encapsulated in universal love, which is Christ. You are expected to have purity of heart. Forgive all offenders, no matter whatever anybody do against you, due to you in this world. Forgive that person. When you do that, and you believe in Christ, then the blood of Jesus Christ becomes your portion of protection.
Okay.
And is the highest.
Okay.
It neutralizes charms, juju, witchcraft, ghosts, mermaid, all this, all of what. You understand? That is what man is supposed to do, to come into the realm of divine protection of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. But the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is Christ himself, also has this prerogative to protect anybody. You understand?
Yeah.
So he can protect anybody anywhere if he wants to. That one, nobody decides for him. So, okay, you must follow. He can, like the thief on the cross. Look at one single statement he made. He said, oh Lord, remember me when you came into the kingdom. He said, today you'll be in the paradise. And the Bible says that no bad person, nothing unclean, will enter the kingdom. The thief accepted to be a bad man. Even when the other thief was telling Jesus Christ, hey, you Jesus, can't you save yourself and save us if you are really the Lord. Yeah. The other man rebuked him. He said, look, don't you know why that we are, he said, we are guilty of our what we are charged with. He accepted the fact that they were not being punished for what they didn't do, okay. That we are guilty. But something makes something to happen.
Okay.
That kind of incident didn't happen ordinarily. Mm-hmm. Because if you study other documents of antiquity, and you study so many other things related to the life and works of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in this world, because the Bible says many things are not written there.
Yes.
You will see that thief, when he was between the age of 17 and 18, 19, was when our Lord Jesus Christ was born.
Okay, that one on the cross.
That one on the cross, the two thieves, one of them, the one that said, Lord, remember me when you come into the paradise. Now that man, when Herod commanded people to kill the children all over his jurisdiction.
Yes.
The mother of Jesus Christ, our Lord, that's Mary and Joseph, they were taking Christ, running away with the infant Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Now on the way, they encountered this thief because they were with gold, frankincense, and all those things brought by the wise men, which were the things that sustained them in Egypt.
Okay.
Now they had all those things, but when they got to where this boy was, he was a thief. That he was still a robin. Then he now went, when he saw Jesus Christ, something touched him. He just showed mercy.
Okay.
He just showed mercy when the child was crying. He now told the parents, Joseph and Mary, he said, take this way. He was able to guide them to take a different short route to escape from the soldiers of Herod. But when the soldiers eventually got there, they were making inquiry whether some people, the same thief misdirected them and told them, just like he sent the soldiers, the parents of Jesus, with Jesus this way. He now told the soldiers that he saw some people running away with children this way. So the soldiers followed that way. By so doing, he showed mercy on the Son of Man, and he became one of the instruments of salvation. Nothing you do for God is rewarded.
Okay.
The word of God say, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. You understand?
Yeah.
So when they during the crucifixion, then the man had obtained mercy. Upon all the fact that he was a rogue and did so many abominable things, for that singular thing he did, divine arrangement, divine providence ensured that he was crucified at the same point with the Son of Man. And he was the one that said, Lord, remember me when you come into your Jesus Christ that says, today you will be in paradise.
Amen.
So what do we learn there? We learn that we should keep on doing good because good attracts good. You understand?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Evil attracts evil, good attracts good. So when we talk about what God does, it works in mysterious ways. I am my own evidence to that.
Okay.
I don't know what somebody may have as evidence, but me, my evidence that God is real is myself. And that's what I tell people, that the Lord is real. You don't need all these charms and not wasting your money to the charms and other things. You know why people do such things? Because some churches have gone down on the strata, on the divine strata. They are just mundane. They're just like social clubs.
Okay.
And so they don't have even the power. They don't even know how to obtain the power. But we are saying that you have to be pure. You have to control certain things, even the way you eat, the way you sleep, so many things. Because if you look at the lives of people of old who manifested the power of God, they didn't live anyhow.
Yes, yeah,
Daniel, look at how he lived. Mm-hmm. Everybody. If you begin to study the lives of giants, spiritual giants that have lived in this world, they never lived ordinary life. Even if you go outside Christianity, and go into other religions, you will see that for somebody to make progress on the spiritual path, it requires discipline. It's not just about accumulating money.
Yeah.
People measure anointing and all those things by this man has come with air. You see, if you come with aircraft now here, they say, okay, oh, that's the greatest anointing. And even if Elijah or Moses come with slippers, wearing slippers, and doesn't have maybe singular, the people will neglect him.
Yeah.
Because they are carried away by material opulence.
Yes.
But we are saying that material opulence has its own validity. But as far as the divine spirit of the Almighty God is concerned, it is not a basis of an assessment. It's a different thing entirely. You understand?
Yeah.
For instance, let me tell you, if you decide now that you want to see some fabrics of spirituality,
okay,
mind how you eat. Don't eat anyhow.
Okay.
You should eat what is not cooked even on fire for 7 days and eat it once a day. You, after that 7 days, you yourself, you will know. You will begin to have awakening of your own intuitions. Somebody may be coming to see you before the person arrives. You already know the person is coming. All those things are just planted. It is the food we eat, all these things we do in this world, the thinking, worry, so many things that lowers our spirit on in the scale. You understand?
Yeah.
Every child of God is under divine protection.
Amen.
In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Okay, viewers, you are still on it. But Daddy, before we continue, still on the life of our Lord Jesus Christ, if you can throw small lights, is it that the Bible Lord just can it use to protect property? Because you'll be hearing people even selling the market that I protect this man tomato with the blood of Jesus Christ. You'll be hearing people saying that I protect this man cap the blood of Jesus Christ. Can the blood of Jesus Christ use to protect physical property or mundane thing? Can they be used?
The Lord told me one day, he said, I am the one who provide what you need,
okay,
and protect what you have.
Okay.
Whatever you have in this world is an offshoot of your being. You understand?
Yeah.
God can protect them for you. Okay. You understand?
Yeah.
But you also have to merit it.
Okay.
When you give to God what belongs to God, sometimes there are a lot of things happening in the divine spheres, in the heavenly spheres governing this earth. You know, God can also allow your material thing in one word or the other to be tampered with, to for an exchange for your own good, but you may not even know it is for your good.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
Yeah. You may come out now, somebody may steal this handkerchief. Let me tell you, anybody who steals anything from another person has taken away that person's problem. If as you are here now,
okay,
if as you are here, there's a plan against you that you made, that you should, something should happen to you, something bad should happen to you in 3 months' time.
Okay.
And so person standing somewhere is a thief. He has been stealing, doing so many things. A divine arrangement can occur so that he can come and steal away that thing.
Okay.
So when he steals maybe your barrel, your money, this and that, don't lament. Give thanks to God. Because you don't know, that problem that will come to you within that period can be stolen.
Okay.
That when you hear blood of Jesus Christ protecting somebody, so many things are involved there. You understand?
Yeah.
So that's why everything is working perfectly for good. For as long as you believe in the Lord, then everything around you is under control.
Okay.
The way it works may not correspond with the framework of your thinking, of your understanding. But as for protection, God protects his children. All you have to do is to depend on him and know that he is that the best. Whatever happens is for your best.
Okay.
We should stop complaining. You understand? Stop complaining and stop being fastidious, worry ourselves. If you say you believe in God, then you're under control, under protection. You understand me?
Yes, well understood.
Yes. So now, nobody steals anything from anybody. This is what we do in this world. This man has duped this person. This person has duped this person.
Mm-hmm.
It's on the mundane level. In the higher divine spheres, there's nothing like that.
Okay.
If I steal anything from you, I have taken away part of your problem and add to myself.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
And all this one, we say we do good. Oh, I do good. Nobody appreciates me. There's nothing like that in the divine spheres.
Okay.
That's nothing like that. Because whatever good I do to you, I'm doing it to myself.
Okay.
You understand me? So you are not doing good to anybody. You are not even harming anybody. You know, anything you do good, you are doing to yourself. You do evil, you are doing to yourself. That is the truth of, that is the reality of life.
Yeah.
That is what people must come to, because many things are involved in divine protection. God uses so many things to bring about protection in different ways. But what man should try to do is that he must make sure that he is faithful to God, even with the material things he has. He should commit portions of the things he has in things that relates to the divine service of the Almighty, selfless service.
Okay.
It doesn't mean you must carry your money and go and give to church. If that's what the Spirit of God tells you, then that's okay. But you see, when you hear that, okay, like in Nigeria now, we have refugee camps.
Okay.
People are having to stay in the refuge. They're human beings.
Yeah.
You understand? If you see a bag of rice, you contribute to their feeding.
Mm-hmm.
You contribute selflessly. If you do it with the, if you do it, bring cameras, bring people, let them come and see you that you are making this contribution. They clap hand for you. They praise you. That's no reward, because that praise and that aggrandizement is the reward. That's no divine reward. But if you can, if you can support such people, you understand?
Yes.
Then secretly do something, you know, and you say it is between you and God.
Okay.
Then such things are recorded in the divine spheres as a work of God. You understand? Okay. People still that they start criticizing different religions. They start condemning people. You don't know whom God. The Lord knows who is His own.
Okay.
I tell people. I even tell Christians. I say, look, there are many things you have to learn from the Muslims. If you look at the Bible, for instance, Abraham bowed his head on the ground while serving God.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane, he bowed his head on the ground. Are you hearing me?
I'm hearing you.
Now, if you look at the Muslims, they bow their heads on the ground.
Every day, five times.
They bow their heads on the ground. But if you look at some of us Christians, we hardly bow our heads. Mm. Some of us even put two of our hands in our pocket and move around while worshiping the Almighty. You have to humble. If you read the Bible, 24 elders, they bow their heads on the ground.
Okay.
So what we do, the Bible says, make sure of all things. What I do now is that I learn from different channels, how God has related with people, spoken to people at different jurisdictions. I take what I know can enhance my spiritual life.
Okay.
So that by the grace of God, I want to be in harmony with the Spirit of Christ.
Okay.
My mission is to bear witness of the Spirit of Christ to the faithful and the faithless.
Amen.
I'm not bearing that witness for financial reward.
Okay.
Yeah, but if God brings blessing along the line, I will take the blessing and use it also to bless others.
Yes. Okay.
That's what we do. In this country today, there are so many people under our care. So many people. So many. Some days I wake up, before 10 o'clock, I have more than 200 and something requests.
Okay.
Some days more. Some days, every day. You see, sometimes when I sit down, I say, okay, this is what the politicians are passing through. They put a lot of pressure on them. And that's why some of them become corrupt, in order to satisfy people. People, everybody should work and have something to do. Don't depend so much on a human being.
Okay.
Don't depend so much, you become a serious burden on a human being.
Okay.
Eh? A serious burden. See, the higher principle is, blessed is the one whose life, don't let this your life disturb anyone.
Okay.
And don't let the actions of another person disturb you. If you can achieve this, then you have come to the path of perfection. That is, don't let your action disturb any human being in this world.
Okay.
Don't let your thoughts, your words, or your deeds disturb any human being in this world. And don't let the thoughts, the words, or the deeds of any human being disturb you.
Okay.
When you come to that platform, you have struck a balance in the divine spheres of existence.
Okay.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah, I'm hearing you, Daddy.
So, and whatever you have, remember the poor. Share with the poor. The people have the propensity, because when you give out something today, they say, okay, this man is a Father Christmas.
Yeah,
that's what they do to me. Oh, the harbinger is a good man. He's a Father Christmas. Many of them come for worship, not because spiritual, but because of the money they will get, because of the school fees and house rents. And at the end, they don't come with so many. You see, some men of God, like I was holding a program somewhere, and one woman, but the woman is a widow, she now came. came to hold the bishop. I was talking with the man of God outside as well. He came to him and said, Papa, please, I have not eaten food. Like, the man of God shouted at him, said, go away from here. This is not the time for those kind of a thing.
Okay.
You see, some men of God put up that attitude to avoid. And so that woman will not go to that man of God again.
Again.
Because she will feel disgraced. But the Holy Spirit said, give her something, I gave her. And she stressed me from that time, okay. You know. Even eventually, we gave her money to start business. We started training her children. And when this one will tell this one, oh, that is how that man of God is.
Yes.
This one will tell this one. So,
man
will be coming. So, what we do is that within whatever resources we have, don't eat alone. Share what you have with people in love. He that is alone dies alone. You hear me?
I hear you.
So, you make sure that whatever you have, if you are a businessman, then make sure that you budget something every month.
Okay.
You say this is for the poor. Okay, look at us. You know about the book, The Path of Light.
Okay.
Volume 1 and Volume 2.
Okay.
We gave it out free.
Okay. Yeah.
We gave it out free for since I celebrated my birthday.
Yeah.
Till we say okay to the ending of the year. We are giving it out free.
But money was used to print.
We used a lot of energy, money and everything. But now, how many people have appreciated, say, okay, man of God, you're giving this out free. I am supporting with this for that. Many, if you ask my secretary, thousands, we have distributed more than 30,000 copies free of each volume.
Okay.
Then if you join them, it's more than 60,000, more than 60,000 copies. Free material.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because we want people to learn, to know. But you see, somebody somewhere ought to say, oh, let the Lord be glorified.
Yeah.
Not say, oh, that man is there for the Christmas. Okay, he sent a book to me free. Go and ask him. No. Somebody somewhere is supposed to say, okay, let us also support this mission.
They can continue to do more.
So that more can continue.
Yeah.
That's the mentality of human being. If you follow the mentality of human being, you'll be discouraged in the work of the Lord.
Okay.
So what you do is that you understand that you are working for the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
Forget about human mentality. But whosoever stands, that is the covenant I have with God. Whosoever in this world stands with the harbinger of the last covenant to support what he's doing.
Okay.
Such a person will never lack. And at a certain stage, if the person is sincere, the divine spirit of God will vomit wealth. And many people are enjoying that. But people don't know.
Yeah.
They want to take. And if you want to take, if you represent those who will come to take, if we have, we'll give you. If you represent those who want to give so you can be blessed, then you come, you'll be blessed.
Okay, thank you. Okay, viewers, you are so on it. As I've been telling you, this is a child between father and son. About the divine protection on how God Almighty, but Daddy, in continuation, God Almighty, the God that created the heavens and then the earth, the God of heaven that I normally call, the God of miracle, how does God also protect his people in connection with what we are discussing, the divine protection? How does God Almighty protect his people apart from the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that explains to us? Apart from the mutable laws, how they operate in relation to the divine protection, apart from also the elements, how does God also, in his own absolute aspect as God, how does he also protect his children?
Let me tell you this. The protection is already there.
Okay.
The spirit of protection is in motion.
Okay.
The Lord told me one day, he brought a bucket of water in the spirit.
Yeah.
He called me. He said, look at this bucket of water. There was cup. He said, if 10 people are drinking from this water,
okay.
If 3 are situated in the light of Christ,
okay.
they fetch water, the same cup, take the same cup, fetch from the same water and drink.
Okay.
He said, before him, those that are standing in the light of Christ, they are drinking with different cups.
Okay.
And they are drinking from different bucket and from the different water.
Okay.
So in this case, now, if there's any battery inside that water, if there's any poison inside that water, it will not hurt the believer. But there are people who see them drinking from the same water.
Same water.
So there are angelic works, angelic beings guiding so many things. You understand?
Yeah.
Now, you stay in an environment. That environment where you are, if you have the light of God,
okay.
Yeah, and the other people in that environment doesn't have that light. It is you that have to generate that light. Because physically speaking, you are living in the same environment.
Okay.
But in the divine space, you are not living in the same environment.
Okay.
You understand?
I understand.
Now, when you look at it, you see, it's just like a man. This man, a man of God.
Yeah.
It's a story about someone who knew God to the point of giving thanks to God in all things. Whatever happens to him, anything he hears in this world, he will say, Father Almighty, I thank you. Because if this thing did not happen, something more than it would have happened.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah.
Now, people knew him for that. And one day, the king of that community died.
Okay.
And when the king died, they came to tell him, because he himself was a prominent person of the community, and a wealthy person also. So when they came to tell him, he said, oh, we've lost the king. The man said, oh, Almighty Father, we thank you. For if this did not happen, something more than it would have happened.
Okay.
People became angry. They say, what would have happened more than the death of our king? From that moment, they started plotting how to harm that man, how to do something to him.
Okay.
Because they felt, okay, it's when people something happened to people, he would say, we thank God. Let's do something to him. So his daughter that traveled abroad was to come back at a particular day. You understand? And some chiefs and people, were prominent people, were in his house waiting for the daughter to arrive.
Okay.
And himself sent his driver to go and bring the daughter from the airport. And the airport was located a few kilometers outside the city gate.
Okay.
So, and those same chiefs and elders rejoicing with him, waiting for the daughter,
yeah,
secretly sent hired assassins,
okay,
to stay at the gate and kill the daughter. Because the idea, their own plan is that, okay, when the death of his daughter is announced, let us see how he will say, oh God, I thank you, for if this did not happen,
yeah,
something more than it would have happened. Yeah. So, they now the hired assassins were waiting at the entrance of the gate. Then the driver that went to the airport, upon the arrival of the lady, when he entered the father's car, within the premises of that airport, as the driver was driving out,
yeah,
he had accident,
okay,
and the guest sustained a minor injury and was rushed back to the airport clinic.
Okay.
And the driver left the car there. Eh? And took what they call, that's the motorbike. I'm talking about this motorbike that runs this. He just chartered one motorbike,
okay,
to carry, to take him. So the bad men at the city gate were surprised to see that same driver that went to collect the gear,
mm-hmm,
on a motorbike going back to the house.
Okay.
So they now came back and joined. So came, but you know when they were bad men hiding to kill the gear. But you know when they come out, they will also come out as friends. That's why these are some of the reasons I wrote a book, Know Your Enemies, Watch Your Friends.
Okay.
So when they now came to gather where the father of the girl was, the driver broke the news, said, oh, Papa, my master, we had an accident.
Oh.
And your daughter sustained a minor injury on his leg. She's being treated at the airport clinic.
Okay.
Please, the man said, no, don't complain. Don't complain at all. The God that serves does not entertain complaint. Oh, Almighty Father, I thank you, because if this did not happen, something more than it would have happened.
Yeah.
That day.
Okay.
The bad men came out.
Okay.
They say, this thing you have been saying for ages, for long, we have confirmed it to be true today.
Okay.
Of a truth, if this thing did not happen, if this small accident didn't happen to this, your child, okay, your daughter, yeah, would have killed her. So this, your word is true, that if this did not happen, something more than it would have happened.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is divine protection.
Okay.
You see, that small accident was used to protect the girl from death.
Okay.
But you have to be in knowledge and see the finger of God to be able to appreciate that.
Okay.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said that blessed are the pure in heart,
yeah,
for they shall see God. See God doesn't mean open your eyes. No. Seeing God means seeing the finger of God in all manifestations,
right,
in all realities, in all situations, in all circumstances. You don't ask yourself, say, what is the devil doing in my life? No. If something is going somewhere, say, oh God, you are the one doing this. What have I done to bring about this? That's what it should. You see his finger in everything. But you have to attain a level of purity of consciousness and of heart,
yeah,
to come to that platform. So that was the example that man said.
Okay.
You have to learn how to give God time. If it is some people that are not in knowledge, do you see them complain? Oh my God. Yeah? Look at what the devil has done. So this is my daughter today, they don't want me to celebrate. My enemies have come. No. Are you hearing me?
Yeah, I'm hearing
So If you want to serve God, you must learn how to see the finger of God in all situations of your life. Okay. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you, son.
God bless you too, Daddy. And thank you for the expositions that we are having today. We know that it will help everybody to ascend the path of light. But Daddy, before we continue, Before we close,
let's all that is.
Yes, I know. But Daddy, I want you to, you just mentioned something that even if one or if 10 people is going to drink from one bucket with one cup, and within the 10, there are three situated in light before God Almighty. They'll be using different cup and they'll be drinking from different buckets, and they will be drinking different water. That cannot throw more light on this for us, because it doesn't, it is not in line with principle or reasoning or whatever it, that is mundane.
Yeah, yeah, it doesn't need to be in line with the principle or reasoning. The Holy Spirit does not follow human reasoning. What we are saying is that if this is a bucket of water,
okay,
and this water, this is a bucket, that's a cup, and that cup is contaminated,
okay,
and that bucket, everything is darkness have taken over,
okay,
and they have poisoned it. And whoever drinks it will die.
Yeah.
10 people gather to drink it. What we are saying is that if 3 people there are situated in light,
yeah,
the people will see them drinking with that cup and drinking that water. But in this, in the divine sphere of the Holy Spirit, they are drinking with a different cup.
Okay.
And they are drinking different water. That's the work of the Lord. That's divine protection.
Powerful.
You see, it's not physical. It's not something that is like physically oriented, that you the cup is there, you take the same cup, okay, but as you are taking that cup to drink, the Spirit of the Lord has already changed the cup. As far as you are a child of God, that cup, that one that the enemy poisoned, is not the one in your hand. Everybody will be seeing it as the one in your hand,
okay,
but as far as the Spirit of the Lord is concerned, a different cup is given to you. You drink a different cup. The person that poisoned is something, that's what Jesus Christ said, that if you believe, you will take up serpent, and even if you drink poison, it will not hurt you.
Okay.
But you have to believe to that point. You have to believe to that point. You don't have to fear. You understand?
Okay.
You say, fear this man, fear this. And then the Spirit of God, the Word of God says, God has not given us the spirit of fear,
okay,
but of power and of love and of a sound mind. You understand?
Yeah.
So that sound mind means that you must convince yourself that you are capable of believing in God.
Okay.
And this happened to you according to your belief.
Okay.
You understand me?
Yeah, well.
The Lord bless you.
The Lord bless you too. Okay, Daddy, before we end, I want to introduce some new books from the Having of the Last Covenant that is ready for now, in order for people to excel. I have here The Hidden Truth of Man and Woman. It's an open letter to the earth man. Whosoever that is a man walking on the surface of the earth, this is your book. You have to know what the Having of the Last Covenant, the exposition that is made. But Daddy, briefly, can you brief us why you wrote the book, The Hidden Truth of Man and Woman, just 2 minutes, 3 minutes, so that people will got to know what is your open letter to them is all about?
Yeah, 2-3 minutes may be long because of my task schedule. But however, you see, The Hidden Truth of Man and Woman is a book of some deep mysteries, unveiled for the first time on earth. This book contains certain things that are coming to the earth for the first time. It's talking about what people inherit in the in-between life. The issue of in-between life is not generally known in religious terms. And I didn't even know much about it until the Lord and 4 holy angels came to me and started educating me. This, I was commanded to write this book, Hidden Truth of Man and Woman. It's an open letter to the eight men. The word eight men is used here, not limited to men. It's human beings,
okay,
man and woman, we call them eight men. So there are women that are carriers of blessings.
Okay.
And there are women, and when a woman is a carrier of favor, there are different conditions attached. Like this is a woman carrying favor.
Okay.
This is conditional attached. This is conditional attached. This is conditional attached. So
okay,
this is a deep something. It's a deep book. You know about it.
Yeah.
Then there are some women too that are dry leaves of the desert. When you tangle with them, you are finished. There's a whole lot of things.
Okay.
A whole lot of things.
Okay.
You understand? And what role should a man play to be able to tap, because woman is the one. You say he that founded a wife, founded a. There are a whole lot of mysterious things written here, mm-hmm. based on divine messages. Most of those divine messages are also literally published as received. Okay. Like when the book of Genesis said that the water was flowing from Eden to water the garden, and okay. it came into four parts. Yeah. You know, the one that was going to Havilah. One was going to Pison, yeah. One was going to Euphrates and other Syria and all that. Those are symbolic statements. Those things talking like a symbolic statement. You understand me?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. The woman you see in this world now, yeah. Water divine, every woman that is carrying blessing, water flows from Eden to water the garden. That's the mystery there. Okay. And when the water waters the garden, the man that goes there will be free. But if it is a static water, according to the book of the Songs of Solomon,
okay.
You go there, you are finished. That is the entanglement. That is what one has to read this book to understand.
Okay.
Some women don't know that when they hold their husband, like the Bible says that if you do it, that you can hinder that a man should dwell with a woman in knowledge, otherwise his prayer will be hindered. So we have written this, we've made this exposition, and we expect people to assess them, and okay. those who want to have work in higher knowledge
okay.
of the Almighty.
Okay. Thank you, Daddy. Also in continuation, we have the hidden terrorists. This is a witchcraft book, Spirits, that has been written by Professor Akinyi Tanzoma, the Archbishop, the Reverend of Last Covenant. Daddy, please, this hidden terrorist, you have been talking about taste several times. Any time that you open your mouth, you speak about this very book, the hidden terrorist. Anywhere that you stand, you talk little about this hidden terrorist, though that may not be the topic. Daddy, why is it that you always want to speak about this hidden terrorist?
Yeah, before I talk about the hidden terrorist, see this book, there's at the back cover of this book here. My son, Frank Fierker, he read this book. And look at what he wrote here. He said, this book is very deep, more revealing, and very mysterious. That is hidden truth of man and woman. Uh-huh. Yeah. Then something is written here. He said, this book will surely take you into the realms of hidden truth of the ages.
Okay.
Some things exposed here are coming to the earth world for the first time.
Okay.
This treatise is based on deep spiritual teachings which the Lord of the universe and the great angelic beings in the heavenly realms of light gave to the harbinger of the last covenant for publication in the world of man in the course of their divine visitations. It is made for the entire children of men, irrespective of diverse religions, tribal, philosophical, traditional persuasions, and belief systems. For as long as you are a human being, endeavor to read this material. And if you have never read any book in your earth life, endeavor to read this one. Remember, to know the truth takes the fool longer than the wise. Read and know what you never knew. The truth is like fire. It cannot be hidden under dry leaves. So this material, let me tell you, I've written a lot of books, over 70 books, some published on my archives and so on. But I'm telling you, if you have never read any book since you were born, read this book. It's when you read it, you will know.
Okay.
When you read this book, Hidden Truth of Man. But if you talk about Hidden Terrorists, Hidden Terrorists, I'm coming, son.
Okay.
Hidden Terrorists is a book that exposes for the first time also the 10 operational code of the forces of darkness. We have to make people to understand. It's an enlarged version. It's an enlarged version of how to overcome witches and wizards and all the powers of darkness.
Okay.
So this is a complete edition of that, but it's now entitled Hidden Terrorists. And we have now exposed here the 10 operational codes. Somebody read it, and when somebody wrote me from United States or somewhere, I said, apart from the Bible, this is the greatest book.
Okay.
Because I sent it through, this is the PDF version.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So it depends. You see, the African man, you have to learn how to read, because some people say if you want to hide any truth from the African man, write it down and put it in the book. He will not read.
Yeah.
You understand? So, but we have to go beyond that mentality. I don't agree to you, but that was what people say.
Yeah.
I advise you, if you know you want to learn how to overcome darkness and so on and so forth, instead of going from here and here and here to seek for deliverance, this and that, we have given this book practical so that you know what to do. And I'm thinking, which book is it? Okay, this is my current
Mind
book. Rudiments. Mind Rudiments. This, Yeah, Mind Readiness is a book of total spiritual freedom and victory over the spiritualness of astral attacks or the forces of darkness, you see. So we have also brought this out. This is, I will tell my secretary, we may give out some copies of this through the PDF version this December free, but people are not encouraging most of the things given free anyway, but I still have the mind of doing that. Maybe this week we'll just give out some copies free. We will do that. But it's an advanced divine lecture. So if advanced minds, so if you know you want it, you can also be part of what we are doing. And I'll let me use this opportunity to advise. I think this talk is going to our YouTube channel, right?
Yes.
Try to subscribe.
Yes.
To this YouTube channel of Prof. Ike Natanuzoma. We will be making a whole lot of expositions there. Yeah. And from time to time, we may come up live. Like next week, we'll be somewhere, but we'll be addressing ministers' conference in Cameroon. But it will be through the YouTube platform. So.